like to introduce a few people we have here with us today. Our county executive, Jonathan Delagrave, district attorney, Patricia Hanson, and Captain Brad Friend from the Racine County Water Rescue Response Team. So this is a sad day, a very unfortunate, sad day to report. We've had a number of unfortunate deaths in Lake Michigan, two to be exact, and one person fighting for their life. When I call in persons, these are actually children we're talking about today, which makes it even that much more sadder. Let me walk you down the road of why we're here today. This last Saturday, which we all know was, you know, just impromptu Father's Day, great weekend, a lot of families out celebrating, things of that nature. At approximately 6:29 p.m., we received a 911 call of a child in the water, approximately 10 years old. That child was was out with friends and family, and unfortunately she could not swim and she was in shallow water. A strong current pulled her out, and our water rescue response team, the boat patrol, removed her from the water 25 minutes later, and unfortunately, she passed away. Several minutes later, 6:35 p.m., a 17-year-old male south end of North Beach near North Pier was also out swimming. There was no lifeguard on duty at this time. This individual's name is Yalyander Singh, 17 years old, and passed away, unfortunately, as rescue efforts being made to obtain him. We found him about 200 yards off of shore, unfortunately. He was taken to Ascension via Flight for Life to Children's Hospital and died the day after. Yesterday, we have two 14-year-old females swimming in the same end of south end of North Beach near North Pier. Two 14-year-old girls out having fun on a beautiful day swimming. As our deputies approached after a 911 call because they were in distress, they noticed that they were being pulled off by a very swift current and near deeper areas of the waterways and near the rocks. One girl was removed from the water. She sustained cuts and bruises and scrapes from the rocks. The other female, 14-year-old girl, unfortunately, is in critical condition today via Children's Hospital. Now, we talk about North Beach, and we talk about this wonderful Great Lake that we sit on here in Racine County. It's a beautiful place. We work very closely with the city of Racine, but today I wanted to call upon city leadership to examine the lifeguard situation that we have down there. We look at the timing of these two unfortunate deaths that we've had, 6:30. There are ample signs down there that suggest that the guard is there from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. We're dealing with children here. How many children are actually reading these signs? There are a lot of signs down there suggesting a lot of things. I would propose that we have extended hours. I would propose that we have more lifeguards. I would propose that we have additional signage warning. We're here from Captain Friend here talking about rip tides, rip currents, undertows, and things of this nature down near piers and rock structures. These are danger zones, and we need to have an educational piece. To this extent, our dive team will be down on North Beach this Saturday from 8 o'clock in the morning until 4 o'clock. More of it as an educational piece, as friends and families gather around down there to meet our dive team members who are very, very informed and are essentially experts in water rescue. Where is a safe place to swim? When is the water acceptable to enter? So we'll be doing that this Saturday, and we'll see how that is engaged with the community. And again, at this point, I guess I want to say this, is that we, on behalf of all of us, and that's why we have our district attorney here, we have our county executive here, our county leadership here, is to, anytime we have children that die in our community, it really rocks the emotions of all of us, especially when there's senseless deaths that could have been prevented. And that is why we're all here today, to really extend our deepest condolences to the family members, especially the 10-year-old Aisha Fiargo, especially known as Naomi, 10 years old, to extend our deepest condolences to those family members. I cannot imagine, as a father myself of three children, what that is like to lose a child, especially on Father's Day weekend. I just cannot imagine what they're going through at this hour. So with that said, we'll entertain any questions you have.
Do you think some of those proposals you just mentioned, do you think some of those could have prevented these deaths, or do we know anything about their swimming abilities, or were the conditions so rough that it wouldn't have mattered?
Well, as we know, Lake Michigan is very unpredictable. In terms of the hours that I mentioned, well, naturally, if you have people that are trained in life-saving, they're elevated on a chair out there. If you've been out there, they're sitting up high so they can see. They have a better field of view. They are trained swimmers. They have the ability to throw a PFD to somebody, potentially. And when these occur at 6:29 and there's nobody there at 5 and the beach is still full of people, I would submit to you that we need to do something about it. And I hope it captures the city leadership's attention.
There's lifeguard shortages get enough lifeguards to be out there?
That would be a very good question for your mayor.
There are issues in Milwaukee County with a very similar beach, McKinley Beach. It was shut down. Is there any talk about possibly shutting down a beach right now to examine this situation?
I'm not aware of any conversations about shutting down beaches. But let's talk about this for a moment. We just came out of a pandemic where we told our entire community to basically lock themselves away in their homes. We have great weather this summer. Everyone is out and about. It's Father's Day weekend. People are out on these beaches. I don't know how you begin to shut down those beaches and effectively tell people they're not going to go in. That would require law enforcement to force people to tell them not to go into the beach, not to go into the water. And we know what those budgets are looking like as well. The solution is we need to reach out and hire more people and put on these beaches that are trained, lifesavers, posting more signs in these danger zones so we can hear more about those danger zones and why riptides are very unpredictable and they're claiming lives clearly and currents that are unpredictable. But to have people that are trained on that beach, to have people that are ready to respond and at the ready, in my view, could have made a difference.
Is there anything that's come up regarding the shoreline, the way it's shaped, that's contributing to these dangerous conditions? That
sure, I can speak to that.
Absolutely. Thank you.
So I look at it from an educational standpiece. Riptides and rip currents are very dangerous events. This happens throughout the Great Lakes. Of course, we've heard them in the oceans. So from my standpoint, it's an educational piece that the public should know. So anytime you have a major change in wave height, the potential for riptides or rip currents exists. In Racine here off the North Beach, we have the concrete causeway that forms part of our harbor. This is a very natural area for those rip currents to exist. And it's not a place that the public should be swimming. So this has, unfortunately, this particular area, we have had some rescues and deaths, of course, over many years. So that is a very dangerous area. Anytime that you have a riptide, there are two things that you can do to try to save yourself. And both of those involve not panicking, which can be a hard thing to do. If you can swim laterally, basically across the beach, across the water, to get away from these riptides, that is, if you're a strong swimmer, that is a potential life-saving technique that you can do. Or you can relax and let the current basically pull you out, and then you can swim to safety. These currents typically only last a few hundred feet. Sometimes they've gone as far as 1,300 feet. But in all cases, you need to remain calm. Now, the conditions that we've experienced in the last few days has been extremely wavy. Along this causeway, we have a number of large rocks. With the zebra mussels, it's very hard to navigate in those areas. So I would urge the public to stay away from the causeway. Really, anywhere you have large structures like piers, stay away from those because there is a higher potential for riptides in those areas.
Are there signs? Forget that. I'm not there. Are there signs posted that don't swim here?
So there is a sign that says that particular area is not a protected area. So.
Does wind direction play a part in just how severe these riptides are?
Wind direction plays a part insofar as the wave height. Whenever you have a major wave height shift, you have the potential for riptides. Anytime that the waves are breaking on the beach, you have the potential for a rip current. If there are no waves breaking on the beach, you will not have a rip current.
Would you recommend that there should be like buoys or something, you know, close to that pier, close to those rocks that kind of suggest that swimmers should stay away from that area in the water itself rather than just signs?
I know there are buoys out in Lake Michigan. I don't think that is going to help save anyone. These currents typically go from anywhere from 2 to 8 miles per hour. And even if you're an Olympic swimmer, you're not going to swim back to shore in one of those currents. Again, the best thing to do is swim parallel to that current. Again, if you're a strong swimmer and not panic. So again, I think education is one key component in this.
Some of these drownings have been where they're swimming with a friend. You know, what would be your advice to someone? Should they help the other person or should they try to get themselves to safety?
I think if you have someone that's in the water panicking, it's a very difficult situation, trying to calm them down reasonably. If you have someone that is in a full panic, you do risk the chance of drowning yourself. I've been in those situations being on the dive team now for 21 years, so it is a very dangerous event. Again, the best thing to do is stay calm. Obviously, swimming, learning to swim is a vital life skill. The YMCA that we have here in our community has swimming lessons. I encourage all families to go out and use those resources.
What time did yesterday's incidents occur, and were they beyond the scope of the lifeguard at the North Beach?
With yesterday, they were along the break wall. I'm not exactly sure how far away the nearest lifeguard chair was to that incident, so I really can't speak to it.
I mean, four children, two of them, three of them may not, you know, survive. I mean, given how much that has happened in the past few days, and people heading out there today, in the next few days, will this prompt immediate action?
The dive team will be there on Saturday. We're going to be doing an education piece from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. We'll be educating the public on rip currents specifically, but basically tips and tricks and things on how to stay safe, some tips for parents and their children. So we are going to be out there. We encourage the public to stop by, interact with our dive team, our professionals, so that they can learn how to keep their families safe.
What's the typical response time of the dive team? So how long does, you know, someone have between the time they call 911? Because we know drownings can happen in a matter of seconds sometimes.
So the Racine County dive team, we have a number of members that come from all around the county. Many of my team members live on the east side of our county. Many of them live on the west side. So our response time is pretty good. To get a full team there, it does take a little bit of time. But we usually have people there within minutes.
Do you know what it was yesterday?
I do not. I don't know the time frame.
Well, I can tell you we have a Racine County Sheriff's Boat Patrol is out in full force during these summer hours. And in all three of these events, they were there and within minutes doing what they could. But this is an effort that requires a lot of membership. It requires a buy-in from our community, an understanding, knowing your own personal abilities when we decide to visit and step our feet into the water. But also from our city leadership as well, making certain that, you know, they're good partners on shore and we're out in the water doing, you know, doing the rescues. We need all partnerships on hand here. You know, one thing I'm sitting here thinking about as well is I know they have those stationary poles where they have PFDs attached with rope where the average citizen after hours could run and grab those. These are all things that we can think about, what we can do to make that beach safer. But it does require people to think about spending money into this area. We spend a lot of money on tourism in this county, getting people to enjoy the lake and the beach and the beachfront and all the rest. I think we need to start looking at the dollars we spend right there on the beach as well to keep people safe. I firmly believe that the fundamental role of government is in fact the protection of the people. And the more we start looking about that, whether it be fire services or paramedics or police, or in this case, lifeguards, now these things, when they get shortcut and shortchanged, you see the results. We have three children, two of which are passed away, and one fighting for her life today. That is the result.
We talked about what the city can do. What about what the county can do in addition to Saturday's
demonstration? The county has already been out on the boat patrol. We have two large vessels out on the water. We have a long-standing history of being out there assisting boaters, assisting individuals who are struggling swimming. We have the Racine County Water Rescue Response Team, comprised of how many members?
15
members, highly trained individuals. We're the ones out there with our feet in the water. We also need others to jump on board and recognize that this is a matter of public safety.
Well, with the county executive and DA, what will be your role in trying to make some change here?
Well, first and foremost, the three drownings are tragic, but there's been other incidents as well that we almost had two more drownings. In fact, we had four brave men by the Racine Yacht Club having to form a human chain two Saturdays ago to rescue a young girl. So this is very prevalent of what's going on. And I also call on the media to help us get our message out and educate those who are potentially going down to the lake. So thank you very much for coming here. We really need you guys to get our message out. In terms of the county, you know, we look at it, as the sheriff says, as said so eloquently, in terms of recognizing the danger to our citizens. We're going to put our dive team out there to educate. We need community conversations. But as far as I'm concerned, we're done watching this occur. If the county has to put out resources, we're going to find the resources over the next few weeks. And we'll man that if we have to. Because you can't put a dollar amount on a human life. And I think our residents of Racine County will back us up every time. So we're done watching this. And we're going to do something about it, but it also takes partners, as the sheriff said. It takes community conversations. It takes education. But we're done watching this. So we need your help. We need community conversations. But we are going to move ahead and do something about this and address it.
Is there a chance that the surviving 14-year-old might be willing to talk and tell her story? I would think it would be pretty powerful.
I suspect any time you would have someone that could share that story. Right now, at this hour, we're, we're all praying for her that she pulls through. So hopefully we can get to that point. That would be a very powerful story to hear. Our thoughts and prayers right now are with her, and hopefully she survives.
Were they swimming together? Were they friends?
It was my understanding that they were swimming together and that they knew each other. And as I mentioned earlier, my previous comments, that as our patrol deputies pulled up in an effort to help them, they noticed that there was a strong current pulling them out. And in fact, we had two of our deputies, as the boat patrol was pulling the one out of the water, our deputies literally jumped in their uniforms into that water to try to facilitate that rescue that much faster.
Has anything changed over the 21 years that you've been doing this?
I wouldn't say anything changed. What the county has done, what we have gotten to do quite a bit more through our sheriff here is the PR work out in the community, is the educational piece. I know the county dive team, who I'm in command of, we've been to numerous schools throughout our county and teaching the little ones the water safety. We also had a chance to work with their parents at places like the YMCA to teach this educational piece. So unfortunately, tragedies do happen in our waterways, but that educational piece has always been a very important part of the Sheriff's Office mission.
If I could just add to that, when we talk about what we have done over the years with the county, I mean, we took 10 years ago when I became the sheriff, we had a 5-day-a-week boat patrol, and there was talk about even cutting that back. Working closely with the county executive at that time, I pushed for a 7-day-a-week boat patrol so that we have protection out of those waterways. We look at our budget every year, and every year we're looking at different types of safety devices to put in our patrol squads, devices, PFDs to throw to people should that need arise. We have a lot of bodies of waterway, not just Lake Michigan, but also the west end of our community that we also patrol as well. So there's a lot of equipment, a lot of training, a lot of technology advancements that we have put on our boats, in our squad cars, with our dive team, that have facilitated rescues that this news group has reported on in the past. We've had success.
How much does it cost now to do what you do to help rescue, or 5 days a week, 7 days a week, and how much more would you necessarily need? I mean, the city can do its part, but if you all are willing to put your resources in there, how much more do you really need?
I believe the county executive said it well when he said, you know, what dollar amount can we put on rescuing human lives and saving human lives, rather. Usually, I don't have numbers for you today if you're looking for an exact number, but when we talk about adding lifeguards, we have to look at the price of putting employees down there. You'd have to look at, you know, the cost of additional equipment. I've talked about potential more PFDs placed strategically around those areas where, as the county exec shared that story with people near the yacht club performing a human chain trying to save someone's life, what if there was a PFD we could have thrown at a person with a rope and pulled that person in? I'm not a big what-if person, but I do know one thing. We have to do something. As the county exec said, we cannot stand by any longer and watch children die. We have an obligation.
Can you talk about what kind of a toll did this take on some of the deputies who went in after these kids?
It is an emotional time. Obviously, we're dealing with children and young adults here. So my deputies, we do have a very strong emotional support network. We work closely with our chaplain and the employee assistance program. So. And we do debrief. We do critical stress debriefing when we have incidents like this. So there is a support number.
So just to clarify on the impact and reach of the riptide, the drowning of the 10-year-old, was that due to a riptide that was enhanced by the North Pier? Can we say that?
Could
we
say I don't that? Think we can definitively say that. We do know that those ripped currents do exist in that area. For each particular incident, it's kind of hard to say exactly, but education is definitely a part of that. You know, educating the public as far as when riptides do occur, and that's what the team is going to be doing this coming Saturday. Obviously, having strong swimming skills is another component to that.
So, is it fair to assume that the riptides have been stronger than normal in the last few days?
We can't speak to that. There are resources. The National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration does put out a daily conditions report. So if there are riptides in the area that are reported, NOAA will, they will report on those, so you can check that. Other than that, it's just educating our public about what exists out there.
I guess
a wonderful resource to have.
Could you ever could the Racine County Sheriff's Department share that report? If they, you know, report that day there's a strong rip current, could you share that on social media?
Absolutely. Yeah, we could definitely put a link to that.
We oftentimes do share that information to as well, not just with other community hazards as well. National Weather Service is also a good service as well. Our boat patrol uses that often to determine the height of the waves and the conditions, and there's alerts that are put out constantly by the National, excuse me, the Coast Guard as well. There's a lot of different resources out there. It's just who's reporting them. And I would welcome you to research the rip tides and rip currents specifically. They're very unassuming. It's hard to tell where they're at. They describe them as a sort of a river on top of the water. They extend from 20 feet to potentially up to 200 to 800 feet. As the captain said, you'd have to be an incredibly strong swimmer to even consider swimming against it, much less going parallel to it. So.
Probably wondering what the district attorney has to do with any of this. I'm certainly not here today to emphasize criminalization of violations at the beach. That's not why I'm here. I'm here because part of my job as district attorney is to play a role in the protection of children. Sometimes that's from abuse, sometimes that's from neglect. But here we have a situation where I think I can at least bring the attention that I think is necessary to try and educate the public. This is, if you will call it, one of my soapbox issues, and given the opportunity, I talk about this a lot. I think water safety in our county is critical, not only for the beachfront, but we have multiple lakes in the county, and we have a lot of kids in our county. My children have been swimming since the first day that they could. I was a lifeguard here in Racine County, working for the county myself. My children swam competitively. So swimming is near and dear to my heart, and anything that I can do to lend a voice to that sort of education that we're talking about here today, I'm going to do it. And so that's why I'm here today, and I'm proud to be here with my county partners and trying to take a proactive approach to the problems that we're having. This is devastating for the community, for these families. Yes, we have a beautiful asset in our lakefront, but we have to use it safely and make sure that everyone goes home safely.
The city of Kenosha did pass an ordinance, I think, last year prohibiting swimming within X number of yards of jetties and piers and whatnot. Would that be a practical thing to do down there?
That's a good question. What I would say is that, you know, the sheriff, the DA, and myself were proactively committed to to the best of our ability, not to have another drowning. And we are going to look at ordinances if they make sense. It's hard to legislate safety. That's why education is so important. But we are committed to proactively getting involved. Just a quick short story, when the second incident happened, I was reaching out to the sheriff on our phones. You go and you start texting. Well, I could see him. He was texting me. I could see the bubbles on our phone. We were talking about the same situation. And how do we proactively address this? That's why we're here today. But like I said, the county is immediately going to go back, work with our partners, and we're going to do what we can and what we have to rectify this issue, because as the DA, I think, so eloquently stated as well, is these are our children, and the safety of our children is a community responsibility, but it's a county responsibility, and we're going to do, like I said, everything we can to make sure none of this happens again.
Do you anticipate meeting with some city officials?
We need together? Community conversation, so that's with the city, that's with stakeholders, that's with residents down by the lake or down by the beach. We need those. We know that there are a lot of families that continually utilize the beach as a recreational standpoint. We need to contact those families through social media and whatever else we can do. So absolutely, community conversation with all stakeholders is critical at this point.
Do you know how many drowning victims there were last year, last summer?
Yes, zero.
Do you know how many there have been year to date so far, or summer to date at least? Have these been the only ones this summer?
I don't have the answers to that.
I believe these are the first two fatalities we've had, and the third one who's fighting for their life. I believe these are the first three victims that we have thus far, and I hope it is the last three. And I think if we have anything to do about it, it will be the last three.
One thing I would also add is that, again, getting the message out is those who want to enjoy water, we have two state-of-the-art aquatic centers in Racine County. One in Burlington, one in the city of Racine. They are lifeguards. There are lifeguards there, so perhaps that would be an alternative, and we encourage people to use our water parks. The rates are very friendly to families, and we will look at continually look at those rates, and if we can lower them to get people maybe who potentially want to use the water but aren't strong swimmers and get them to move to our aquatic centers, we're going to do that as well.
This might be a question for the captain, but as far as the education piece goes, how is swimming in, like, learning to swim in a pool as you would, different from swimming in a lake or a strong body of water?
So swimming in a lake, the currents and things are unpredictable. Typically in a smaller lake, it's going to be a bit more controlled. You got to understand, Lake Michigan is very dynamic. As the winds shift, as the wave patterns shift, it can create these very dangerous conditions that we don't see in some of the smaller lakes in our western community. So Lake Michigan itself it can be very, very dangerous.
Is there maybe a portion of the education piece when kids are learning to swim, maybe, you know, taking them out for a day and teaching them to swim in an ocean, a lake, or is that, you know?
To the county executive's point, I think starting, say, at an aquatic center, the YMCA is a good example of that, in a controlled situation, and building those fundamental skills, I think, is the first good step after, you know, to build that experience.
And water confidence leads to when you are.
Just to make sure we have it, can we have you guys just say and spell your first name?
Captain Bradley, B-R-A-D-L-E-Y, last name is Friend, F-R-I-E-N-D.
Christopher Schmaling, S-C-H-M-A-L-I-N-G, Sheriff, Racine County.
Jonathan Delagrave, Racine County Executive, J-O-N-A-T-H-A-N-D-E-L-A-G-R-A-V-E.
Trisha Hanson, T-R-I-C-I-A-H-A-N-S-O.
Any additional questions regarding this? I'd like to take the opportunity to say thank you to all of you for being here today and getting this message out. It is a very important message to all.